Speaker, this government and this budget delivers for every Australian. A tax cut for every taxpayer. Wages growing in every industry. A better deal for every working parent. A fairer go at every checkout. New help with energy bills for every household and for small business.
Good evening, I'm Ricardo Gonçalves, and that was the Treasurer Jim Chalmers handing down his third budget. Shortly, in this SBS World News Budget special, we'll get the latest reactions from Parliament House. But here are the key points from tonight. A forecast surplus of $9.3 billion this financial year. Cost of living relief in the form of tax cuts and rent and energy subsidies. Billions of dollars in local manufacturing investments. And an expectation that inflation will return to the Reserve Bank target possibly by the end of the year. Our chief political correspondent, Anna Henderson, is standing by from Canberra. Anna, you've been through the papers today. What's caught your attention?
Ricardo, this budget is ambitious and there are some elements that verge on audacious. It's a big spending document that relies on inflation forecasts that are ahead of Reserve Bank predictions, as you said. The big question is, can this Labor government pull the economic gamble off?
Walking a budget tightrope with little margin for error. A back-to-back budget surplus in sight.
Last year, our responsible economic management delivered the first surplus in 15 years. We now expect another surplus of $9.3 billion this year. Yeah.
But the reality facing millions of Australians is far less rosy.
Speaker, the number one priority of this government and this budget is helping Australians with the cost of living.
Energy bill relief for every Australian coming from July. 10 million households will get $300 off their bills, a million small businesses $325, expected to shave 0.5% off headline inflation. There's more relief for renters too, with Commonwealth rent assistance to grow by 10%, student loans to be slashed by $3 billion, while the highest rate of job seeker will be extended to singles with limited ability to work. Getting an extra $54.90 a fortnight, that's $3.90 a day. And of course,
our new tax cuts for middle Australia are the biggest part of the cost of living relief in this budget.
A broken promise that'll see tax returns rise from $500 for someone on median wage to $1,300. For a wage earner on $100,000, they'll get a tax cut of $2,000, that's $800 more. But returns for those earning above $200,000 will halve. But will the budget drive down inflation?
You've set an expectation that it could reach target range by the end of the year. What if you're wrong?
Oh, well, those are the forecasts of the professional Treasury officials. The budget is expected to play a substantial role in helping inflation come off a bit further and a bit faster.
This is a relatively big spending budget. It has the potential to put upward pressure on inflation and means the Reserve Bank could increase interest rates as a result.
Despite this year's surplus turnaround of $10 billion, future debt is deepening. The budget positioned $13.9 billion worse off to 2026-27, with baked-in spending on aged care, health, defence, debt and the NDIS. The budget revealing $14 billion will be slashed from the scheme over 4 years.
We want the system to work better for everybody, but it cannot keep growing at the way it is currently growing.
Structural debt paired with a sluggish economy, with growth projected to stagnate around 2% over the forward estimates and wages just outpacing inflation.
These long-term challenges highlight the practical and political need for Labor's budget centrepiece to succeed. A future made in Australia now carries a $22 billion price tag, an ambitious agenda to turn Australia into a renewable superpower.
With loan subsidies and major tax incentives, including $6.7 billion to encourage investment in green hydrogen, $7 billion for critical minerals. Boosting skills will be key for the economy of the future, with plans for 8 out of 10 workers to achieve a tertiary qualification by 2050, setting out a path for the next generation. Now the budget sell begins. Sarah Temevska, SBS World News.
This is a government acutely aware of how tough life is for millions of Australians right now. I spoke to the Treasurer, Jim Chalmers, a little earlier.
For someone thinking about whether they can pay their bills this week, what's in this budget for them? Well, I'd say to the people who are under pressure, we understand these cost of living stresses and strains that you're under, and more help is on the way in this budget.
You maintain that this energy bill relief, $300 per person, no matter their income, from the wealthiest to the poorest in the country, will not fuel inflation. But economists are already suggesting that they disagree with that. Why don't you agree with the economists?
Oh, well, there's not a unanimous view amongst economists. There very rarely is, and there isn't on this occasion. You know, the very clear advice that we received is that a combination of our cost of living policies, particularly our energy bill relief and our rent assistance, will push downward pressure on inflation without adding to inflationary pressures elsewhere in the economy. There will always be a range of views about that, but we're pretty confident we got it right.
The suggestion is that an interest rate moderation would follow. And so if this doesn't unfold the way you are hoping it does, what do you think that the Australian public will say?
Well, I think people understand that we're doing our best to get on top of this inflation challenge, which is absolutely punishing people around the kitchen tables of this country. You know, we understand people are under pressure. More help is on the way in this budget.
How many people have to lose their jobs in order for us to achieve this inflation forecast?
Well, what we are attempting to do and what we've been able to do so far is to see inflation come off substantially at the same time as we maintain a pretty low unemployment rate.
There is a difference though. Do you know how many people end up in the unemployment queue to get there?
Well, even as the unemployment rate ticks up a little bit in the Treasury's expectations, in the forecasts I released tonight, we will still be creating extra jobs in our economy. So the unemployment rate goes up a little bit, but we are creating more jobs for people. And that is consistent with what we've been able to achieve so far. We created 780,000 jobs under the life of this government as inflation has moderated. And that shows that we can be attentive to the labour market at the same time as we get on top of inflation.
The future made in Australia policy, for it to work, people have to want to buy Australian solar panels at a premium. So would your government consider putting a tariff on Chinese solar panels?
Primarily, this is not just about solar panels. It's about this vast industrial and economic opportunity presented to Australia and Australians by the global transformation to net zero. And that's why we want to attract more investment. We want to give a tax break for production in areas like renewable hydrogen and processing critical minerals, because the future of our economy is a combination of these industries in the Future Made in Australia policy and the care economy. And in the budget, there's investments in both those sets of industries.
Can you say hand on heart that people's living standards have improved under your government?
I can say hand on heart that every minute that we have been in government has been about helping to ensure that people can earn more, keep more of what they earn, we get real wages growing again, because that's the best way to turn around this challenge that we have with living standards and particularly with inflation.
I'm yet to see a budget that pleases everyone who lobbies in this building, but I think you could say this one has been polarising, Ricardo. Here's political correspondent Pablo Vinales.
The complex process of constructing a budget is always a balancing act between those who secure their wish list and those left disappointed. Calls for more support to assist people most in need were loud and consistent ahead of the Treasurer's speech in the Chamber. At the same time, businesses big and small were hoping for signals to help drive the economy forward. Inevitably, it's left some disappointed.
The 2024 budget is a pretty modest document that's not really going to shift the dial one way or another in the year ahead. The budget makes it very clear that tough economic times are going to linger. There's a lot to like in the budget supports, particularly for smaller business continuing. They are most welcome.
It's difficult to see that this strategy is taking significant pressure off inflation, taking pressure off costs and prices.
We still have a stagnant private sector investment into the housing market, whether it's owner-occupier, whether it's mum and dad investors, or whether it's institutional investors.
The reality is that from next year, private schools will receive $1 billion over the next 4 years, while public schools get nothing. The public knows that there is deep inequality with respect to school funding in Australia, and it's time for the Albanese government to step up and address this.
I think patients and families around the country tonight will share a sense of disappointment. We have not seen a lot of investment tonight.
The government's banking on its vision for clean energy to hit the mark, and that how it's curated the Stage 3 tax cuts and other spending measures will resonate. It's already getting some strong support.
This is a great budget for clean energy. This budget is historic in the single biggest government commitment to clean energy in the nation's history.
We're pleased to see in this budget the federal government has put in place more building blocks for universal household electrification and the build-out of renewable energy on our grid.
We are still within hours of the release of the budget and understanding what these figures mean. Ultimately, it will be the reaction of voters. That's the biggest test.
A disappointing decision for supporters of an Indigenous treaty. The government has not funded support for the process going forward. NITV correspondent Cameron Gooley has the details.
In the first budget since the resounding defeat of the Indigenous Voice referendum, the government appears to have walked back financial support for all aspects of the Uluru Statement of the Heart, including the proposed treaty-making and truth-telling authority. Despite receiving $5.8 million in funding 2 budgets ago, Jim Chalmers has confirmed that funding for the Makarrata condition has been diverted elsewhere in the portfolio for closing the gap outcomes. The $20 million that was also set aside to create local and regional voice bodies has also been reallocated. Now, this budget has a real emphasis on closing the gap in Indigenous affairs, with a particular focus on employment and housing. The two signature policies are the $774 million plan to create 3,000 new jobs in remote communities and the $2 billion 10-year plan to create new housing in Northern Territory homelands.
Cam Gooley there. And Ricardo, I just want to take you to a key table in the budget. It's been dubbed the Table of Truth. It shows the impact of what the government chooses to spend on the surplus, which next year becomes a deficit with many more to come.
Well, despite cost of living relief, the government is forecasting inflation will fall to within the Reserve Bank's target of 2 to 3% by the end of the 2024-25 financial year and possibly before Christmas. That's earlier than what the RBA itself expects and, as a result, may trigger interest rate cuts. But is it being too optimistic? I've been speaking with former Reserve Bank Assistant Governor, now Westpac Chief Economist, Lucy Ellis.
The government designed a lot of its cost of living packages to reduce measured inflation by the end of the year. That's what we expected in our own forecasts. And so we do think that their inflation forecast for the end of the year is achievable. The real question is how much the additional money in people's pockets adds to demand and how much the other additional spending adds to demand. But in the short term, we are going to see lower measured inflation because that's the way the government has designed its policies.
OK, so what do you think then the Reserve Bank will think about all of this, and could it still lead to lower interest rates by Christmas?
I think the Reserve Bank will have expected that this is what the government was going to try to do. Although the Reserve Bank's inflation forecasts are higher, that's because they don't factor in policies until they've been announced. But our estimate of what the government was going to do was broadly in line with what we expected. We think that this will be in line with what they were hoping to achieve in terms of lower inflation. We don't think this really shifts the dial in terms of the RBA's actions.
So what is Westpac's forecast for when the first cut in interest rates will be?
We expect that the Reserve Bank will have seen enough of a decline in inflation to start cutting rates by November and then keep cutting a little bit moderately through next year until they finally get to 3.1% by the end of the year.
Looking ahead, is there any prospect of further budget repair, and what are the implications of this?
Well, Ricardo, let's put this in perspective. The government's just announced that they've recorded a second successive surplus. The budget is expected to swing into deficit, partly because of the additional spending that they are doing, but they're expecting a 1% of GDP surplus. That's not that big relative to most peer economies. And we know that by the time we get to year's end, they will have had revenue surprises because iron ore prices won't fall as much as they usually assume. There are a number of other aspects of conservative assumptions that they quite properly make in the budget. So, you know, while the medium-term prospects for, you know, higher spending to deal with our, you know, ageing population, to deal with the cost blowouts in the NDIS all need to be dealt with, we're starting from a much better fiscal position than most other economies.
That's Westpac Chief Economist Lucy Ellis there. Now let's head back to Canberra and to Anna Henderson. Anna, how has the opposition responded?
Well, the opposition has seized on this budget, describing it as a fantasy document. The government has been working hard to drive down immigration, in part to address that fierce political battle over its management of that area. But it's clearly cost of living that Shadow Treasurer Angus Taylor was zeroing in on when I spoke to him earlier.
We've just seen an inflation forecast detailed in this budget. Do you believe it?
Absolutely not. I mean, the truth is that we've seen raging inflation under this government, and there is nothing in this budget that is going to tame that inflation.
Let's go to one of the measures they're putting in place to try and alleviate the burden. That's the energy payment relief.
Sure.
Will you back that in the parliament?
We're happy to go with that, but frankly, this budget does not solve the underlying problem. It doesn't go to the source of the problem, and Australians will remain poorer under Labor as a result of this budget, which is spending over $300 billion more than when Labor came to power.
What about the Future Made in Australia Fund? Are you prepared to support that?
There's $13.7 billion here in production tax credits, and giving billions in handouts to billionaires is not something we can support. And we certainly don't think it's the way to have a strong manufacturing and resources sector, which is what we want to see in this country.
What policy are you going to show on Thursday night?
Well, that'll be up to Peter Dutton, but I tell you, it'll be focused on taking pressure off Australians' cost of living and, most of all, taking pressure off inflation.
That sounds like a tax policy is coming.
I'm not going to make our announcements tonight, but I will say it will be absolutely focused on that number one issue Australians are facing, which is a cost of living crisis, which this budget does not address. Middle Australia was forgotten again by a Treasurer who is out of touch and doesn't understand the underlying economics of what Australians are facing.
That was Shadow Treasurer Angus Taylor not giving too much away when he spoke to me in Canberra a short time ago ahead of the budget reply on Thursday night. Those are the first takes. There will be many more to come tomorrow, Ricardo, including our coverage of whether voters are embracing the government's vision.